Hi, everyone. I know that we are already thinking about lunch, so I will try to keep it short. Thank you for joining. Thank you for coming here. I work for Zalando, where I have been focusing mostly on some of the components of Zalando's data lake. And for this reason, like the subject of large-scale analytics and table formats is very relevant to me and to what we are doing at Zalando. Before I start, I would like to make two disclaimers. First of all, this talk has been put in the developer track. However, it is still an overview, so I hope you still find it technical enough to be interesting. But certain things I will basically discuss in a very, very general terms. And the second disclaimer is that I would really appreciate any kind of feedback after the talk, so that I can improve it, especially if the feedback is both negative and constructive. Yes, so let's start. There will be like four sections in this presentation, and the first one is going to start with why we actually need a table format on top of our big data deployments. Then we are going to see how this can be solved. Then I will present quickly how we use one of those formats at Zalando, and maybe discuss what can future hold for us in terms of table formats for large-scale deployments. Now, I realize that by now everybody is kind of maybe tired of hearing about ACID, ACID, and so on, but those are very, very important abstractions that are offered by certain systems, and we somehow lost them when we moved to the world of the big data, and it's a really great shame. So let's maybe do a quick refreshment on what they mean. Atomicity means that if there is one transaction that contains multiple operations, it will either fail completely or succeed completely, which means that no reader nor no other writer is going to see partially successful transaction. Consistency may mean several things. This is actually the one of the this is the broadest, I think, of the four. It may mean, for example, that from the perspective of a reader, certain invariants in a table or in a data source are preserved, which, for example, may mean that if a column should have only unique values, this is preserved regardless of the operations done on the data source. Another meaning of consistency can be that if a certain set of transactions has been committed, transactions has been performed on top of a data source, two readers that are completely independent are going to see the same data when they try to read it from this data source. Isolation is mostly about two transactions not. First of all, not seeing like partial, so it is kind of guaranteed by atomicity to some extent, but from the perspective of the reader, it means that if we have two concurrent transactions that are modifying the data source, the effect will be as if they were actually performed one after the other. We will not know exactly in which order, but this equivalence between the but there will be an equivalence between some ordering of those transactions being executed in a row. And there is also durability, which means that once a data source acknowledges that a transaction has been committed, we can be sure that every reader and every other writer is going to see the results of this transaction. Now, those properties are guaranteed by basically every like single node database, like from our perspective, maybe a simple system, but still to maintain those guarantees in a system, even in a single node database, it still takes a lot of work because you need to have on top of the data files, there will be like transaction logs, there will be metadata about the schema, indexes, write-ahead logs, and so on. And there will be this like entire machinery of query planning, query execution, scheduling, managing transactions, managing logs. And all of this is going to be covered by the communication layer, which may mean, let's say, a RESTful API like in Elasticsearch, or for example, an interface that is like ODBC or JDBC, one of those protocols. Things get slightly more complex when we are moving on to distributed databases, because now we have, while they are still designed as if they were a single black box, now all the nodes, regardless of the topology of the cluster, need to reach consensus on the current state of every transaction, of every log, of the data, which means that also like the information between the nodes needs to contain a lot of information on, for example, how did the replication go between the nodes of the cluster. And in distributed databases, we usually have some options, like in Cassandra, for example, where we can actually trade one characteristics for the other characteristics. So, for example, we can gain a bit of speed in terms of transaction persistence, so on the D side, while losing a bit of consistency because we have selected to, we have chosen to configure the cluster with a lower replication factor. But still, some of those databases, well properly configured, are designed to actually still give us all those like ACID protections, those abstractions. For example, FoundationDB is a project that aims to bring full ACID properties to like fully distributed database. However, this is not what we are dealing here with, right? Like, if somebody is coming to this conference, we are usually dealing with much more complex infrastructure. Our deployments actually consist of multiple distributed systems, schedulers, writers, Spark, Flink, stream processing. We have distributed readers. We have Redshift. We have Presto. We have Athena. We have libraries for data science, for example, that read those data sources and try to train a model or maybe make a prediction based on the input from other source. We have applications that we expose to customers of our organizations, APIs that also make use of this data. And if all those, if like this entire ecosystem is communicating through a storage layer that is usually also a distributed system on its own, it can be a deployment of HDFS, it can be an object store like S3 or let's say Google Cloud Storage. Which brings so many complexities in terms of integrating those systems that over the years, as the complexity of those systems grew, we kind of forgot about ACID transactions because we have settled on the lowest common denominator in terms of how we express tabular data, which is basically this classic ACID, not ACID, but Hive style table. In this kind of table, we have the only thing that we basically can rely on is the layout of the table in terms of partitioning. Maybe we can rely on bucketing inside of the data files. However, there is no other isolation between readers and writers. So both readers and writers do a lot of listing. They work on data files directly. There is really not a lot of metadata that can help us make sense of it and actually offer those four guarantees. Atomicity is lost because a transaction, or let's say an operation that makes several writes, like it can actually, like the results of this transaction, of this operation can be visible to other readers or other writers. Consistency is lost because now we may see duplicates if there is, let's say, an update operation on a file, which means writing a new file usually and deleting the previous one. And this may mean that in the middle of this operation, a reader is going to see duplicate entries. Isolation is completely lost because, again, if two writers can see what they are doing, I mean, the isolation is simply not there. And from the perspective of readers, durability can also be lost. Because while the underlying data storage is usually guaranteeing us that once we put an object there, it is going to be there. It still may be that because of like eventual consistency of, for example, S3, this file is still not available for listing for one of the readers. And because of that, from the perspective of the reader, that the transaction is kind of not durable because it is like the effects are still impossible to be discovered. So not all is lost. We definitely, as a community of professionals, have came up with some solutions to those issues. And I think the biggest push for that came in the last maybe 2 to 3 years, when a certain table formats they were announced or gained in popularity. And I would like to discuss three of them. But let's maybe start with this section with what actually a table format is. So given some kind of distributed layer of storage, first of all, we would like to make sure that the underlying characteristics in terms of the storage do not determine the characteristics of the table. So we would like to know that, for example, eventual consistency of our object store is not making the table itself eventually consistent. So we have to have some kind of other mechanism for going around this issue. On top of the data files, we will definitely have a lot of metadata stored somewhere that is going to describe the data, that is going to describe the transactions that are ongoing, that is going to contain write-ahead logs, statistics, some kind of indexing information. And basically, a table format is the description, a specification on which storage layer it can be deployed, which are the data formats that you can use for the data files, and how is the metadata defined. So let's start with the oldest transactional big data table format, which is ACID ORC. This one is essentially an extension of the typical Hive table. And it has been there for quite a long of time because it has been available since before Hive 2.x. However, there are some differences from version to like big, from large version to version of Hive between them. And the basic idea behind it is that, first of all, you can define it the same way you define any other Hive table by just adding this transactional property, setting it to true. One thing to remember here is that ACID ORC tables cannot be external tables because the assumption here is that the table is fully managed by Hive, which means that like the word external doesn't even make much sense. And what happens underneath is that in the location of the table, we still have this partitioning by folders. However, inside of those folders, we will get, first of all, a folder with like the base data of the table that starts at a certain transaction. And then we will get folders with two types of deltas, insert deltas and delete deltas. So every transaction that is going to update the table is going to create one or more of those folders. And in every folder, you will get files that are containing the same buckets as the files that have been somehow modified by this transaction. For a delete operation, you will only get a delete delta. For an insert, of course, only an insert delta. And if you want to do an update, it will actually contain, it will actually create a delta for a delete and a delta for an insert. Transaction management in ACID ORC, so transaction tracking and so on, is done internally inside of Spark. You have to inside of Hive. You have to configure Hive to use a particular transaction management class. You have to configure certain parameters like compaction rates, and you are set to go. One thing to remember here as well is that there are two ways to compact a Hive ORC table. There are so-called minor compactions that can be triggered automatically, and minor compactions are going to compact only deltas together. and major compactions are going to take the base compacted with all the deltas and finally create a new base folder. So those are pretty expensive operations that are comparable to like fully full optimization of a Delta Lake table. When it comes to like basic advantages and disadvantages, first of all, AC to ORC tables, so the bigger advantage is that once, if you already have a Hive deployment, it is pretty easy to move on to AC to ORC. Because of the way updates and upserts are done, because like there is no need to rewrite an entire file that is being updated, creation of deltas is pretty simple, so upserts and updates are pretty fast. And the movement between two versions of Hive, so let's say if you plan to migrate your Hive to 3.x, you can do it pretty easily. However, you still have to perform a major compaction of the Hive 2.x table to be able to use it with the next version of Hive. And of course, if you decide on this format, you get the commercial support from vendors that support Hadoop. I think currently the most important one is Cloudera. However, there are limitations to this format. So first of all, currently the support for Spark is really not that good. There is an open source connector from Cubel that is developed very fast. However, currently the only thing that you can do with it is read from an AC to ORC table. So you can use it as a source, but you cannot use it as a sync to your or as a target of your writes from the data frame. Because once a lot of the, so slow listing and metadata discovery. So again, all of the metadata information is still being maintained inside of the Hive metastore, which can be a performance bottleneck, especially for tables that contain, that have like thousands of partitions. And another problem here is that we have slow listing because if a reader has to list all the deltas to understand what is there, even a basic read can take quite a lot of time. Plus, the read itself can be slower because the reader has to perform an ad hoc compaction before it can actually understand what the status of a given bucket or a given partition is. It is ORC only. That's the only data format that is supported. And if you want to go around the issue of eventual consistency of S3, you have to either use something like S3 Guard, which is a library that you can install on your, let's say, on your Spark cluster, or if you are using EMR, you can use like the consistent this option to enable the consistent view. It is possible, I didn't check that, to be honest. It is possible that actually the consistent view is using S3 Guard because they are using the same mechanism of tracking the current state of an S3 location. Namely, they use a DynamoDB table to track that. The second format that I would like to show you today is Iceberg. Currently, it is an open source project being incubated by the Apache Foundation. Development of Iceberg started at Netflix. They wanted to solve two issues, given the fact that their tables were pretty enormous, millions of files, heavy listing operations and metadata operations because of thousands of partitions. They wanted to speed this process up, to speed up mostly the query planning phase. And the second issue they wanted to solve was snapshot isolation. And the approach that Iceberg is taking towards solving the problem of guaranteeing ACDC is completely different than that of ACID-ORC. Basically, everything is a metadata operation. So every snapshot, so first of all, the movement between snapshots is only in one direction. You have basically a linear progression between snapshots, which is similar to what Delta Lake does. And every snapshot is determined by a file that is a list of manifest files. Now, in those manifest files, you will get a list of data files belonging to this particular snapshot. What is happening there is that if you want to move on to the next snapshot, you can still share manifest files between two manifest lists. So the update, let's say if there is a write transaction, the next snapshot will only update the metadata that is relevant to this particular transaction. You don't have to rewrite all the manifest files. In this case, listing is very fast because the there is a inside of Hive there will be a pointer to the latest snapshot, and your reader from there can basically identify the manifest list, branch to manifest files, and quickly identify every files that are relevant to this particular snapshot. One of the biggest advantages of Iceberg is that it supports three data formats, so Parquet, ORC, and Avro as a storage. You can basically pick and choose any of them. The second point is really, I think, the most important feature. So let's go back to this slide. One thing to understand about Iceberg is that it doesn't do partitioning by folders. Partitioning information is stored in the manifest files as well, which means that the, whether a file belongs to a partition is just determined in the manifest file. What is pretty awesome about it is that if you want to repartition your table, this is a metadata operation. If you want to completely change the partitioning layout of the operation, all you need to do is write a new snapshot and rewrite the manifest. You don't have to do anything with the files themselves. Second of all, partitioning is, I would say, virtual. You do not have to have an explicit partitioning column. You can say, my partition values are computed from the timestamp column, where I take the date of this column, and this is how the partition information is calculated. Which means that if you want to have a table that is, let's say, partitioned by day, you can still do this partitioning based on the timestamp column. You don't have to compute the times, the date column explicitly. Another thing is that Iceberg offers really robust options for schema evolution. So essentially what you can do is, first of all, you can rename columns, because every column in an Iceberg table gets a unique synthetic ID. So even if you do a rename of a column, Iceberg will understand, or a reader of Iceberg will understand that this is the operation that happened. Second of all, on every level of nesting, in terms of like structs or dictionaries, you can have, you can remove columns and you can add columns. So this is completely allowed. Even better, you can base your partitioning values based on one of the nested fields as well. There is already a Presto connector merged into the Presto repository, which means that you can use Iceberg not only with Spark but also to read from Presto. There is Iceberg offers time travel that is basically has like full feature parity with Delta Lake. So you can list your snapshots, you can query particular snapshot, you can query snapshots by date, time, and so on. And when you, in current implementation of the, at least of the Java libraries, you can simply use them in any JVM application, because you do not have to provide the methods that are working, that are modifying the table or reading from it. You do not have to provide a Spark session object to those. So you basically can integrate this library with anything that is using Java or Scala, any kind of JVM language. Now, one of the weaknesses currently is still support for Spark, because while you can read and write to an Iceberg table from Spark, it is unfortunately impossible to do anything in terms of Spark SQL. Only data frame operations are available. In Spark 3.0, apparently, like full support for Spark SQL is being announced, but this is still in the future. The documentation, I would say it's better to go actually to the specification part of the documentation than to read the rest of it. You can see that this is not, that Iceberg is not a product per se. It's a commercially backed project, but it's still not something that is being sold. And because of that, there is currently, as far as I know, no commercial vendor that can offer a support for Iceberg. And the specification is still pretty immature, which means that it changes pretty fast. It evolves, which is like poses certain risks if you would like to deploy this format in production. And of course, last but not least, the one that with which we are the most familiar, especially after the first day of the conference, is the data lake. Delta Lake started as simply as Delta. It has been a closed source format developed by Databricks. And given the fact that we already know quite a lot about it, let's quickly go still through how it is organizing things. So the layout of a Delta table is kind of like a hybrid between Iceberg and ACID-ORC. We still get the folders that are dividing data into partitions. However, there is this Delta log folder directory in which you can find separate files representing each incoming transaction, each committed transaction. Every 10 transactions, there is going to be a parquet file with a checkpoint created that consists of like the full. This is a full checkpoint, full snapshot of the metadata that previously happened, so that you don't have to basically compact as a reader all the previous files. And you also get the latest checkpoint file that is pointing to the latest checkpoint, which means that in case, at least in case of readers, if you would like to read the table pretty fast and you don't want to list like this growing transaction log, you can simply check the file, go to the latest checkpoint, and maybe compact it together with at most 9 other transaction entries. The biggest advantage, of course, one of the biggest advantages of Delta Lake is an absolutely amazing integration with Spark, which is not a surprise. Not only full integration with Spark Structured Streaming and with DataFrame API, but also with Spark SQL, including the merged syntax, which is very useful in certain ETL processes. Time travel, again, moving between snapshots. Very well written documentation. It is actually like you can easily see that this is a commercial product, and it is something that is very well documented, and you can basically learn everything from the documentation instead of trying to go over the internet and look for like blog posts or maybe some other sources of information. It is being quickly developed. We can see like every year we see basically how much the format is advancing. From announcement to announcement made by Databricks. Vacuum and optimize, I put them specifically here because they, both of those commands, of those operations, offer a lot of control on what we do with the table once the transaction log is getting too large. So as during the previous talk, it was already mentioned that auto-optimization can already happen. It can be configured, but you can still fully control, and it is transactional as well. And vacuum, of course, lets you fully control how many snapshots back are still available, how far back the history of the table is being preserved. And there is an announcement from Starburst that they are going to publish an open source connector for Delta Lake, which means that integration between Spark or Databricks and Presto is going to be much, much easier if you use Presto as your reading engine. Now, there are two disadvantages that I would like to mention. Again, Parquet only, ACID-ORC is ORC only, and Delta Lake is using only Parquet, which may or may not be a disadvantage, but it is somehow limiting the format currently. And the fact that the issue of multi-cluster writes, so multiple writers on top of object stores, is still not solved as part of the open source implementation. So you can have, because HDFS offers consistent listing, you can easily have multiple writers without any external metastore writing to the same table in a safe manner. However, in terms of S3, you have to use, currently it is only implemented as a component that you get with the deployment of Databricks. However, there is also already a discussion inside of the community of Delta Lake on how to implement it as well as an open source solution. So that was the overview of those tables. I would like to spend now maybe 2 to 3 minutes discussing how we are using Delta Lake at Zalando. So this is a diagram that represents one of the biggest use cases at Zalando. We have a data pipeline that is transferring around 300 tables from that, ranging from several megabytes to hundreds of gigabytes from the traditional data warehouse from Oracle and Excel databases. It is extracting change sets or complete tables through Databricks, storing them as Delta, and then using capabilities of Delta to make it easier to merge them into the snapshots that already are stored there. Afterwards, we are doing vacuum and optimize. And in this way, we are doing vacuuming basically with that is not preserving any history of the table, because ultimately what we want to get is a well-optimized, pristine parquet tables. Why do we do that? Well, most readers of this data from our data lake, they are not using anything that can understand Delta. There are Databricks readers. However, most of those reads are done either from Presto or from, for example, by data scientists from data science libraries like Pandas. This pipeline has been serving us for over a year now. I would say it was pretty reliable, and given the scale of the entire process, the processing parts, like this great cooperation between Delta Lake and Databricks clusters has saved us a lot of time during the development. Okay, so once we have some idea about those formats, what do we do next? Like, what can happen next? One thing to appreciate about all those three formats is that, of course, first of all, they are transactional. The ACID transactions are back. Second of all of them now are backed by open source community. There is an open source governance, either through Apache Foundation or the Linux Foundation, which is awesome. I'm really happy about the announcement yesterday about the Linux Foundation. In terms of ACID ORC and Delta Lake, we can get commercial support. We will see about Iceberg. But what is, I think, the most important thing is that the support for all those three formats is getting better and better in terms of how they cooperate with Spark, which means that maybe we do not have to pick one of the three. Maybe we can actually start building pipelines that take advantage of all three formats, given the fact that we can translate between them using Spark. And I think it would be pretty awesome to meet next year or in 2021 at the next Spark and AI conference and actually see presentations of pipelines that are using more than one transactional format to solve business problems and to solve engineering problems when dealing with large data sets. If you would like to do more research about those formats and generally the direction of where they are going to, I have compiled a bunch of links that you can essentially use. I will share those slides, of course, with you if you wish, so those links are not going to be lost. And yes, with that in mind, I would like to thank you for your attention and ask if you had any questions.
Thank you, Michael. We've got about 6 minutes. We got two mics on either side. Please come forward if you ask any questions. Please make it short, because I'm sure some of you are hungry and want to go back and eat some food. So let's go. Go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thank you for your first speech. And am I right that Iceberg is all about compacting just the metadata files, but Delta compacting the parquet file itself? So it might take much more time to compact the real parquet files?
Yes and no. So there is definitely foundational work already done for compaction of the files themselves. Mm-hmm. However, I'm not sure how far is the work on the physical compaction of the underlying data. But given the fact that you can do transactional compaction as a large rewrite, there is, by now, I think, nothing preventing us from achieving physical compaction of iceberg tables at some point. Mm-hmm. Like, there is nothing in the format that would prevent that, to the contrary. Mm-hmm. Okay. So we have to wait a bit, yes.
Okay.
Go ahead, next.
Great talk, thank you.
Thank you.
So my question is, from your understanding, researching this, do you think they are going eventually in the same direction and will serve the same purpose and just community will split into three groups? Or actually they will have different features and serve a bit different use cases?
I think the second thing is going to happen, just like it happened with file formats. Sometimes you use avro because you want to have row storage, row-based storage. Somehow you want. Sometimes you want to have columnar storage, so you go for Parquet or ORC. And those table formats have really different advantages and disadvantages in terms of like reading, writing, listing, and so on. I would, for example, expect the iceberg to become like the way to store the raw data, and then being translated to Delta Lake or ACID ORC as the final product. I think this is a pretty good use case for it.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next. Nobody on this side.
Yeah.
We can parallelize, you know.
Yeah.
That's right. This is raw format. This is the column
yes.
format. Go ahead.
Thanks for the presentation. So my question, at one point you said that Delta Lake doesn't support multi-cluster consistency on S3. Is that right?
It does. However, you have to have a mechanism for maintaining this consistency.
So if you use EMR S3 consistent view, does it work?
Currently, out of the box, no. However, maybe it would work if you again used something like S3 guard or something like that. But given the fact, and among those links, you will find probably a link to a discussion about this particular problem. There is already a discussion how to implement an open standard for managing consistent view on top of S3 as well.
Okay.
So it is coming for sure.
Okay, thanks. And how? Where can we find the slides, please?
We'll be posting the slides.
You can find those slides during lunch.
Okay.
Yes, you can approach me, or you can basically wait for me to exit the stage. We can exchange contacts, and I can send you the slides.
Okay. Sorry, again, a question about regarding the optimize.
Yes.
As far as I remember from the previous talks, they say that optimize it's a proprietary feature of Databricks. Is this right?
I mean, currently it is, but eventually you never know. Things do get.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, okay, I mean, I don't have a good answer here because I thought that it was actually part of the open standard. But if not, then again, I would have to verify. Okay? Yeah.
Anybody else?
We have still 2 minutes. Maybe you would like to give me some feedback or say hi.
All right, give a hand to Michael. Did a good job.
Thank you.